Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me thank you for coming out to support this lecture series and being here to be present at the inaugural lecture. I'd like to pay a special welcome to Deputy British High Commissioner, Mr. Craig Fulton, for joining us today, and we're glad to see him here. Thank you, Craig, for coming. I'd also like to thank our sponsors, and the lecture series is put on by the museum, or more accurately, the Barbados Museum and Historical Society. But we also collaborate and get support from the University of the West Indies Department of History and Philosophy. We get also support from the National Cultural Foundation, and we get support from the Barbados Trailway Project. But this evening we are in for a treat. I'm sure we all know the name of the lecture, that's why we're here. And even if you didn't remember it, we got a little brochure as we were coming in to remind us. And I'll do it again, from invitation to deportation, 70 years of the Windrush generation as the theme, but as the lecture tonight, Britain needs your help, the social and economic context of migration to the UK. Now, we are doubly privileged this evening. It's actually more than double, because Dr. Henderson Carter is not only the programs and publications director within the museum volunteer structure, but he's also a lecturer in history at the University of the West Indies, but not just a lecturer. He's a distinguished lecturer. He teaches West Indian history, business history, and slavery in the US Civil War. He obtained his PhD from the University of the West Indies, and his thesis at that time was an interesting one, which he's continued to tailor a lot of his research, Resistance and Protest in Post-Slavery Barbados, 1838 to 1904. And he's moved from slavery into the new, I say a relatively new field of business history. And he produced the groundbreaking study in 2007, a study called Business in BIM. And what this all means is that Dr. Carter brings a wealth of experience, a variety of experience, and what I would say is a proven eclecticism to his teaching, to his classes, and to his lectures. But this is underpinned by 14 years of teaching at the post-secondary level. He's also the convener of the CXC Syllabus Review Panel for Caribbean History. So this is what makes Dr. Carter not just an eminent lecturer, but a distinguished one, but more particularly one of balance. And I'm sure that when we hear from him tonight, we will think of that word balance, because I've heard him before on frequent occasions, or as frequent as he speaks. If I said frequent occasions, you might think that he's overexposed, and there's nothing worse than an overexposed lecturer. He's not overexposed, he just speaks frequently, and I happen to listen to him whenever he's being exposed, speaking, that is. So he is going to give us a wonderful lecture this evening. You're not here to hear me, you're obviously here to experience him. And I've only been dilly-dallying a bit so as to allow a few more people to come in as they're walking in. Now, I think that has happened, and everyone has walked in so far. And I will therefore pause and hand it over to Dr. Henderson Carter. Dr. Carter.
Good night, everyone. And thank you, Sir Trevor. Again, I recognize the Deputy High Commissioner. We're glad to have you, and we're glad to have all of you today, particularly our migrants. Some of you are here. We also have some UE students as well. And we're glad to have such a big crowd to help us to examine the issue before us. Britain needs your help. The social and economic context of migration. In 2002, Trevor Marshall, historian, wrote an article in the Sunday Sun making the following point, and I want to quote Trevor. He says, "It is high time that some Barbadian historian devote, say, 5 years of their time to analyzing and reporting on that scheme which has decisively affected the culture of Britain over the past 50 years and has equally serious consequences on this island, Little England." End of quote. Mr. Marshall was making a call for a full-scale study of this Barbadian UK movement. I wish to say that a book is on the way. Yes, a book is on the way, and hopefully before November, we will come back here or some other place to launch that book. But I also want to say that this lecture series will deal with the many aspects of the Windrush experience, and hopefully a book will come out of this as well. Tonight's lecture discusses the social and economic context of the Windrush migration. And I want to look at the period from about 1948 to 1962. I'm going to stop at 1962 because there are many distinguished lecturers in this series who will take the story past 1962 on to the present. Is this working? We're getting some help with the movement of slides.
Yeah. It was working. Whether the up or the down button. So you press down.
Okay, this here.
Yeah, the arrows, right, so you start back, so you come from the down. Right.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Our second slide shows the objectives of the lecture. I want first to look at the manpower shortage in Britain, the nature of that shortage. Then I'm going to look at the nature of the plantation system in Barbados. Third, I'm going to survey what I call the culture, a Barbadian culture of migration. Fourth, I will look at this search for economic betterment, the Barbadian search for betterment. Fifth, I will examine government support for migration, and then I will conclude by making three quick points. It has been argued that migrants in the Caribbean were intent on rebuilding Britain, helping Britain, having helped Britain in the war, the Second World War, and the First, they were intent on rebuilding Britain. In fact, Sam King, a Jamaican migrant who served in the Royal Air Force and was on that Windrush journey in June 1948, said, and I quote, "I have been here during the war fighting Nazi Germany, and I came back to help build Britain." So that's King's view. And there were others who came back to help rebuild the country. There's another view that migration occurred from Barbados principally because the island was overpopulated or densely populated. Barbados, as you know, in 1950 had a population density of 1,398 persons per square mile. 1,398 persons per square mile. And when you read the literature in the 1960s, they mentioned population density or overpopulation as one of the reasons why people moved. I wish to argue, however, that the Barbadian UK migration was mainly migrant driven, rather than labor shortage driven. In other words, migrants were seeking social and economic betterment. I also want to say that Barbadians took the initiative to return to Britain after the war. They sent home glowing reports of circumstances in Britain. These reports were backed with money and barrels. And those who arrived formed societies for the furtherance of migration, what I call a migration bridge, forming these societies to help others in the Caribbean to come and to settle. And I also want to say that the government of Barbados was keen on organizing the movement. And in fact, Barbados stands out in terms of this organized movement of people after 1948. And this thesis is supported by Ira Katznelson in the book Black Men, White Cities, Race, Politics, and Migration in the United States and Britain. And this is what Katznelson said. He said, "The average migrant will state when asked that he has come to work to better his economic position." R.B. Davidson also notes in a survey that the reasons for the movement are quite unmistakable. He says, and I quote, "People are flocking from the West Indies to Britain to seek improvement in their economic situation." So my argument here, therefore, is that this movement is migrant driven, and these migrants are seeking economic betterment. I use as my sources the Barbados Advocate, the Trinidad Guardian, documents and correspondence relating to the Federation. And these documents are found in the West Indies Federal Archives. It is a much underutilized archives, and I encourage all of you to visit and to go through the papers, look at the documents. I've also looked at some written and oral testimonies of migrants. I perused the House Assembly debates, especially the interventions of Winter Crawford. Let's look now at the reasons for the labor shortage, or what Britain called the manpower shortage after the war. During World War II, Britain lost many individuals. As a matter of fact, civilians who were killed number over 67,000, and persons, military persons, that number reached 383,000 people. The wounded, 284,000 people. So already you see a manpower issue as a result of the war. But I think this issue here, the need to rebuild the broken infrastructure, adequately explains why people were needed in Britain. During 1940, after September 7th, London was bombed 76 consecutive nights. 76 consecutive nights. And this is just part of the destruction wrought on London. Coventry also bombed in German air raids in 1940 and 1941. Coventry lost 50,479 houses. Could you believe that? 50,000 houses destroyed. Lucille Harris, who was on the Empire in Russia in 1948, says, and I quote, "When I came to England, I live in Brixton, near the market. I tell you, when I came here, there were hardly any buildings standing. The buildings were burnt out through and through." Now, around 1948, when Britain assessed their manpower shortage, it was said in this assessment that 50,000 persons were needed for housing, factories, schools, and power stations to rebuild those things. 50,000 persons. Another 550,000 persons for manufacturing, consumer goods, and re-equipment. For basic industries, they were projecting another 220,000 people. And for the defense services, 500,000. So we have the destruction of several cities, and that need to rebuild those cities as one of the reasons why West Indians were asked to come. Thirdly, the establishment of the National Health Service in July 1948 was critical, especially for nurses who went from Barbados and other Caribbean countries. Britain needed, at that time, an estimated 54,000 people to work in the nursing sector. 54,000, that was the projection to work in the nursing sector because of the expanded National Health Service. English women were not keen on working in the hospitals. And at the same time, according to Anne Kramer, inpatient care increased from 2.9 million people in 1949 to 3.5 million people in 1953. So more patients were being hospitalized and needed to be cared for. So Britain encouraged mass migration, and that encouragement came through the British Nationality Act of 1948, which gave all Commonwealth citizens free entry into Britain. At the same time, however, the United States passed a law restricting migration to the states. So that migrant stream that had started in the 1940s, that was restricted to the state. So you can see where the movement is going. It is going to go to England. Let us look now at the numbers. 1954, this is for the Commonwealth, not Barbados yet, the Commonwealth. 1955 to 57, 40,000 per annum. These are large numbers. 1958 alone, 30,000. 1959, 21,000. 1960, 58,000. And for the first months of 1961, 113,000 individuals. And you could understand why the British are going to be concerned with this movement. But British politicians, some of them, acknowledge the value of immigrant labor. This is what Hugh Gaskill had to say. He's the leader of the opposition in 1961, and they were getting ready to pass a new act. Gaskill said, and I quote him, "In the present circumstances, I do not think that there is the slightest doubt that immigration from the Commonwealth has been of economic benefit to us. We have to get away from the idea that an increase in the working population is a bad thing." End of quote. Lawrence Pavitt, another politician, said, and I quote, "When I go to a school prize giving in my constituency, I look down on the sea of faces, some white, some colored. And as a member of the Central Middlesex Group Hospital Management Committee, I know that our hospitals could not run for 5 minutes without the work done by the colored ward orderlies, the colored nurses, and the junior medical staff from Pakistan and elsewhere." But there was an overwhelming movement. 113,000 in the first 10 months of 1961. And people were scared of British cities becoming colored cities or black cities. And one politician, Mr. Osborne, argued that Britain ought to curtail this movement. He noted that the notion that Britain was a mother country and had a mother country's obligation was gone. He says there were no sister states and not necessarily a mother country obligation. And he moved a private member's motion urging the government to take powers to control immigration from all Commonwealth countries, irrespective of race, color, and creed. At the same time, other groups, nationalist groups, like the White Defense League, the Nationalist Labour Party, the Teddy Boys, and Oswald Mosley set out to defend nationalism and, of course, to give criticism to this movement. And you know that that movement was challenged by the Teddy Boys, and in 1958, riots broke out at Notting Hill, August, September 1958. So just 14 years after the immigrants were welcome, in 1962, Britain passed the Commonwealth Immigrants Act, which really restricted immigration from the colonies. Now, those allowed, however, it didn't stop immigration, it restricted immigration. Those who were allowed were holders of employment vouchers. Students, they were allowed. Members of the armed forces. And entrants who could demonstrate the ability to support themselves. Of course, the West Indians kept coming. And some of them kept resisting, even though there was pressure being placed on them by British people, some kept resisting. And I want to tell you a story about this man, Kenneth Herbert, died recently. And he is related to my wife. That's my wife's uncle. He worked in the London Transport. One day he tells us that he was on the train, and as a conductor, he demanded the fare, but there was this man who refused to pay. And after several pleadings with him, Kenneth got a cursing, and he told Kenneth that he should go back to Mombasa, a place in Kenya. Eventually he paid, but dropped to sleep. And when he dropped to sleep, nobody woke him up. He passed his point of embarkation, and he woke up to find the train in the station in darkness. And Kenneth says that he never saw the man again. But that is how West Indians, some West Indians, dealt with the matter. And I want to applaud West Indians for dealing with difficult circumstances in England. And I hope that tonight you can share some of those circumstances that you faced. So we have, therefore, the British context, a context of manpower shortage, a context where nurses were needed. Let us now turn our attention to the Caribbean. I believe that if we are to examine the reasons why people left, we have to make reference to the plantation system. And this is a nice pick taken from St. John. The plantation system did not offer the circumstances for economic betterment for these workers. First, the system monopolized the best arable land. Second, the system was a one-crop economy with little spin-offs. So you have one crop sugar, a little molasses, a little rum, but not a lot of spin-offs to give you gainful employment. The system offered seasonal labor for about 30,000 people, but at low wages. In the system, we have sexual harassment as well, which came over from the post-slavery period and the slavery period. And a lot of girls, young girls, were not inclined to work in such an environment. In this plantation model, there was hardly any support for manufacturing industries. As a matter of fact, manufacturing only got going in the late 1950s, early 1960s. And that was due to the efforts, mainly, of Winter Crawford. So it explains, therefore, why individuals would want to leave. A lot of young people who were going to school at the government schools, who were going to school at the private secondary schools, did not want to join these gangs of workers in the cane fields. So we have the plantation system. They're running away from that. They're seeking economic benefit, betterment, because the system is not offering full rewards. But there's another point. It is a restricted educational system as well at the secondary level. Most Barbadians at that time went to primary school or elementary school, especially up to fourth standard. But at the secondary level, fees had to be paid, and many Barbadians could not handle these fees. But more than that, the places available were not enough. Law School, for example, in the parish of St. John, had a roll in 1949 of, guess how many people? 255. 255 in 1949. Comma Mayor. In 1947, with Major Newt at the helm, had a roll of 500, and that was large. Queen's College, in the sixth form, in 1949, only offered 24 places, 24 students in the sixth form. So that restrictive educational system has to be factored in, because when you listen to the migrants, they are saying, look, we are going to finish our studies in England. We're going to go to the primary schools. Some of them went to schools like the Modern High School, a later Federal High School, and they moved on with their certificates and finished their education in England. Barbados also had a modest housing stock, very modest. Look at these houses here. These houses are about 20 by 12 feet. Some of them very small, some of them with mud floors. Most of them had pit toilets, grass beds. Many of them were overcrowded. And even though the infant mortality rate was dropping by 1949, it was still about 150 per thousand. Of 150 per thousand. That's very high. Today it is about 12 per thousand. So when we look at the circumstances, therefore, we can see what is pushing Barbadians, what is pushing them. I now want to move on to what I call the quest for economic benefit, betterment. My argument is that in Barbados, there is a long culture of migration. That culture of migration started in the 1840s when Barbadians sought work in British Guyana and Trinidad, and they got higher wages, and they came back with their wages, and they went on a seasonal basis. Some of them stayed in British Guyana. Some of them even went to the Windward Islands, Grenada, St. Vincent, in the 1860s, 70s. Of course, we know that the biggest movement was to Panama between 1900 and 1914. An estimated 40,000, 40 to 60,000 Barbadians left for Panama. And then there's this US-Cuban migration going to work in Cuba in the cane fields. Some going to the United States as well in the first two decades of the 20th century. And they're sending back home tangible benefits. Some come back home with a Panama hat. Some come back home with money, and they show their money. Others build homes. Some bought land. So land purchases were bought with this Panama money. And there's a group that bought five estates, we call them the Panama estates, between 1941 and 1943. So there's this culture of migration. Now, but what about Britain? Who were the first persons to lead this British charge? R.B. Davison, in his book, West Indian Migrants, Social and Economic Facts of Migration from the West Indies, says that it was not the nurses, it was not the men who worked in the London transport. He argues that the origins of this migration can be traced back to those men who served in the armed forces in Britain. And after the war, they went home, could not find jobs, and then returned to Britain. Journey, there were several individuals like Sam King who served in the Royal Air Force and were now returning to Britain because they could not find work in Jamaica. Why then did people migrate? I want to quote from Myrtle Smith, who actually wrote a book called My Encounter with Christ. And she's writing another one specifically on her experiences in England. But in this text, she says that she was sent by her father, and I quote, to earn a living for herself. Sent by her father. In those days, of course, fathers had a lot of authority. Not today. And she noted, and I quote, I thought it was a cruel thing to do. Especially when I was not given a chance to say yeah or nay. Again, that's the power of the father. We need strong fathers again to deal with this system of lawlessness that we have in our country. So Smith was sent overseas to earn a living for herself. There's an obituary that I want to quote from as well. And this is the obituary of Clotel Lashley, née Cox. And I found this in the Sunday Sun of February 17, 2019. And this is how the obituary starts. In 1956, Clotel Cox from Welch's Christ Church left Barbados to pursue a career in nursing in the UK. Her intention was to spend 5 years, then return to Barbados. She never returned to live, and spent 62 years in the UK until her death in 2018. Never returned. The question is, where did they settle? And you can see there are over 35 cities, 35 areas that West Indians settled. London, Bath, Leicester, Manchester, Scotland, Wales, Nottingham, many areas in which they settled. And having settled, they made arrangements for Barbadians who were yet to migrate, or who were coming, they made arrangements for that settlement. So we have what I call a migration bridge, where there are societies in England who meet, West Indians who meet, and they look for job opportunities, they look for housing, they advise about settling in. And this is a lovely ad here that we can see about housing, advertising housing. And those societies speak to organization, the organization for more migration. And that is something that is peculiar to the West Indies, peculiar to West Indians, that when they met, they thought about organizing for more migration. It is said that in Nottingham, they were able to form a housing association. And by 1961, 14 houses were bought, and at least 5 were on lease. They also had 3 women's groups in different parts of the city. And these women's groups took charge of arrangements for the Federation celebrations. So what we are saying, therefore, is that those who went and had settled made the way, paved the way for others to come. Let us specifically look at the nurses. And I have put this slide up because I believe that we need to call these people by name, because these are our heroes. And I hope that some of you are here tonight. And if you are here, your name is on the board, is on the wall, please raise your hand. Gwenny Innes, Silver Sands. This is the first batch of nurses. Elsie Webster, Villa Road. Idalia Ferguson, Britain's Cross Road. Then the second batch, Alfie Holder, Doris Sargent, Ina Phillips, Carmen Maynard, Enid Trotman, Clara Knight, Vlad Edwards, Carmen Belgrave, Olga Miller, Irma Clark, Eugene Tate, and Anise Chatterton. So we see, therefore, that these people are moving in batches, and these are organized batches. I now want to go quickly to what I call organized migration. Migration from the West Indies, to look at the migration in totality, to see how many left Barbados, how many left from Jamaica, how many from the Windwards, etc. Of course, Jamaica led the way. Between 1955 and 1961, 148,000. Barbados was second, 18,741, or 8% of the population. The Windwards, 27,000, or 8.6% of their population. Leewards, 16,000, or 13% of their population. Look at Trinidad, only 9,610. Guyana, 7,141. So that we see, therefore, that the main West Indian movement was from Jamaica, followed by the Windwards, and this is the Windwards collectively, but Barbados as a single country, over 18,000 persons migrated during the period 55 to 61. Let us now look at remittances. Because I don't think Barbadians have understood this point. And this is remittances through the post office. The majority of this is from the UK. And we're talking in 1960 of 2.7 million British West Indian dollars. That's a lot of money. And a lot of people benefited from this. It sent some people to Cammermere, some to Harrison College, some to Queen's College. These remittances ensured a better standard of life. And most of all, it encouraged people to want to migrate. And I think that when we examine the issue of migration, we have to look at how remittances have helped this economy to deal with some of the issues that it faced in that period. I now want to look at the role of government. What role did government play in all this? We've heard about the migrants wanting to move. But what did the government do? First of all, government appointed an individual from Guyana called A.H. Pickwood to be Labour Commissioner in Barbados. And he set up his place at Herbert House, Fontebelle. So we have a Labour Commissioner to deal and to interface with those employers in Britain and to interface with the prospective migrants in Barbados. So that's the first thing Barbados did, a Labour Commissioner. Second, there were government-sponsored immigration schemes between 1955 and 1960, mainly with the London Transport. So these individuals were not going to Britain and not knowing where they were working. When they left, they knew where they were going. So we have over 1,400 people going to the London Transport, 649 hotel workers, 522 student nurses, and people also working as domestics in private households. And this is particularly important because the government did not leave Barbadians to be wandering around London not knowing what they could find. And this government immigration scheme helped to give organization and momentum to the movement. But government did not stop there. I hope I'm not sounding like the Prime Minister, Mayor Motley, in trumpeting the role of government. But anyhow, government ensured that loans were granted to those who wanted to leave. So we have over 14,000 people between 1955 and 1960, 14,000 who got loans. And in British West Indian dollars, that was over 1.0 million. And they got their loans, they paid their passages, and they left. And these are some of the nurses with Grantley Adams, who visited the nurses in England. These are some of the hotel workers. Anybody here who was a hotel worker and could identify yourself? Nobody? Somebody? May I give this man a round of applause? And we're going to hear from you shortly. We're going to hear from you shortly.
I got fired, sir.
You got fired? And you will tell us about that experience. And you will tell us about that experience. And government also protested when efforts were made to curtail this immigration. And I want to look specifically at the letter, the protest letter sent by Grantley Adams, to Prime Minister Macmillan, Harold Macmillan, in November 1961. And I quote, "The apparent determination of Her Majesty's government to proceed with legislation to curb migration from the Commonwealth seems to be in flagrant disregard of every liberal principle on which Britain has based its customs and traditions since Lord Mansfield's famous judgment of 1772. West Indians are firmly convinced that by this action, Britain has begun to take steps which are no different in kind to the basis on which the system of apartheid in South Africa is based. It is inconceivable that West Indians, who form less than 0.5% of the population of Great Britain, can constitute any threat to Britain's economy or health. There has been no evidence," says Adams, "to indicate that West Indians are less law-abiding or moral than the people of Britain whose beliefs in law, freedom, and justice they share." He continues, "It is particularly disturbing that although still legally described as citizens of the United Kingdom and colonies, the people of the West Indies should, even before the final attainment of independence, be subjected to hostile and discriminatory legislation to deprive them of their historic rights to move freely into Britain." And Adams continues, "It will in future be difficult for any person from the Commonwealth to accept unreflectingly the oft-repeated assertion of multiracial partnership. The government of the United Kingdom is therefore jeopardizing not only the future of an association from which high hopes have been entertained, but Britain's own reputation for justice, tolerance, and fair play." And he says, finally, "My ministers join me in an urgent appeal to the British cabinet not to proceed with legislation which can only result in a deterioration of social conditions in the West Indies to the situation in which Lord Moyne found them in 1938. End of quote. Prime Minister Macmillan replied to say that the bill, and I quote, "is intended as a means of regulating total and immigration from all parts of the Commonwealth to a rate at which they can be assimilated." And that was the reply to Adams's letter of protest. So we are saying, therefore, that Adams not only went up with the nurses and entertained them and heard from them, but when it mattered, he protested on behalf of West Indians. And this brings me, therefore, to the conclusion. And I wish to conclude by making 4 points. First of all, I want to call on the government of Barbados to reform the national curriculum so that migration history and other histories germane to the Caribbean, germane to Barbados, can be taught in our schools from forms 1 to 3. Right now, social studies is taught, not history. And that is why we are getting situations where when you tell people Windrush, they ask you, what do you mean? Obviously, it's not taught. So they don't understand. There are some people who have never heard of Windrush. But I call for this to be taught because the migrant experiences are important. And I hope that during this lecture series, migrants will share. Their contribution needs to be examined. What did migrants contribute to Britain? What did they contribute to the National Health Service? We also need to let people know, our Barbadian school children know, the value of the remittances from Britain and, of course, from the United States. We must let them know the challenges that these migrants face, both in the workplace and, of course, in public. And we must also let them know about the challenges the migrants face on their return. And I believe that the reason the migrants face these challenges was because Barbadians were basically ignorant to the value of migration. So I say, therefore, let us reform the national curriculum and put in migration history and, of course, other histories in that curriculum. Secondly, I call on Barbadians to embrace and imbibe their history and drop the silly notion that history is a bunch of dates. Yes, there's this notion. When you mention history, people skid up their faces. And there's this notion that you cannot be employed with a history degree. So why do history? And parents are guilty of this. Guidance counselors are guilty of it. Of course, I must point out that the skills that are taught in history are critical for any person in the workplace. Skills of research, skills of oral and written communication, skills of analysis and judgment. These skills are needed in the workplace. So you're not wasting time doing history. But moreover, history helps us, especially in this case of the Windrush, to understand the migrant experiences and to put the Windrush scandal of 2018 into perspective. So you can't understand the scandal without understanding the history. Moreover, migrant histories create tolerance. Tolerance of our migrants coming back home and migrants coming from other Caribbean countries. When you listen to the call-in radio, you hear the intolerance. Don't come here. Why are you coming here? We ain't got no room for you. Our unemployment situation is bad. No room in the inn. So you hear that. Migrant history also creates a sense of pride regarding the contribution of nurses, for example. And I feel good to know that our nurses, and you know our nurses look well, going over there, working, and of course, earning a living for themselves. That gives me a sense of pride to see Barbadians working hard and living out the motto of pride and industry. And thirdly, migrant history teaches or should teach Barbadians that they too can obtain the necessary skills and pursue any job, any part of the world. So with that history behind us, we know that we can work any place if we have the skills. And finally, I encourage the migrants to write down their experiences, to record their experiences, and to have them publish. I thank you. I want to thank my daughter for doing this PowerPoint slide for me, and of course, for doing the research. Thank you, Felicia, in absentia.
Special thank you to you, Henderson. I said balance at the beginning, and balance it was. One of the beauties of this lecture series is that we get an opportunity to not just question the answer, the lecturer, but to have a discussion with the lecturer, and he has given us a lot of food for thought. Balance, as I said, manpower shortage, just to remind you, the plantation system and the ways in which that, in a sense, encouraged migration. He even introduced or alluded to Winter Crawford and his efforts in manufacturing. I say Winter Crawford because Winter Crawford is someone that very few Barbadians know now and very few remember. But some would also say he's the prime minister that we never had. Economic betterment, the important subject of the government support for migration, and the appointment of Pickwood as the Labour Commissioner, and the government-sponsored migration schemes. Everything was covered here, but I'm sure there's still a lot that we can hear from Dr. Carter. And my role here is now to just open the floor, and if I don't recognize you, it's because standing from here, there is a bright light that shines right into your eyes, and you're all just tiny little objects out there with faces, but I can't recognize them. But before I do that, there's one face I recognized earlier, and I have to welcome, and that is the Reverend Guy Hewitt, the former Barbados High Commissioner to the Court of St. James, and he played an important and significant role in, should we say, bringing back Windrush as a culture and as an economic system to the international public and attention. And I know he is here somewhere because I glimpsed him, but I can't see him now because of the white light. But welcome. But the floor is open, and Dr. Carter is here, and I'm only here to guide you, and not in case all of you decide to ask him at the same time to choose who speaks first.
Good evening. I just want to I don't mean to say that you're wrong, but I remember those ladies that you mentioned that went up to England to do, they went up to be domestic servants in the hospital. Delia Ferguson and Doris Sargent. I knew them, excuse me, I knew them before they went up. They went up to be servant working in the hospital, cleaning the floors and things like that. And those two ladies gave me the inspiration when I went up to go into nursing. I would just like to tell you that I went up in 1956, and as a 20-year-old, and I went up to work in a hotel. I couldn't go up to work with London Transport or British Railway because I didn't have the education, according to the Barbadian authorities. I only went to Standard 5. We were very poor. And so I went up to work in the hotel. And I'm going to give you my experience there. I was fired.
He seemed very proud of that.
We were working one weekend, every other weekend to get off. So one day I went in, excuse me, and they told me that the other fellow would get 3 weekends off and I would get 1 off. Well, you know I'm a Barbadian. You don't have to. I said, no way. I would not stand for that. And they were taken aback. I stopped working and I turned my back to the sink. In other words, I was telling them I'd done work. Well, the chef said, you will have to talk to the madam, the boss. I said, well, get her down here. And she came down. Well, what seems to matter? I said, madam, you know exactly what's going on. Don't ask what seems to matter. I am not going to do it. Well, that is what we want. And I said, madam, you know what? And she said, yes. I said, about 2 weeks notice, and I'm out of here. I went to London. During that 2 weeks, I went up to London, and in the same London British Railway, I went to Euston Station, and I got an application form. I filled it out. They gave me the work to do, did it, and passed, and I got a job on the railway. And I worked there for 4 years. The reason I worked there for 4 years was because I left my dear mother and I wanted to give her a house. And I worked and I wrote and asked my father if he would build a house for my mother. And he said yes, and he did. So that was my greatest achievement in life. I give the house. Thank you. After that, I thought, well, it's time, boy, you look after yourself now. So I wrote 2 hospitals, and one in Birmingham and one in Surrey. And I said, which one responded, I will go. Birmingham called me first, so I went to Birmingham. I did the exam. But they told me, don't go back to London, wait for the results. Well, you know, they fit to give me lunch and so on. And then when the nursing instructor came, she said, Mr. Doughty, I want to tell you that you are a highly intelligent young man. No one has ever yet told me that I was intelligent. So I asked if I would get into the hospital. She said, you're already in. So I did my training, and I'm thankful for that. And I became a registered nurse. Standard 5. Thank you. Thank you. But I must tell you, I was very grateful for the opportunity to go to England, because if I had not gone to England, I don't think I would be able to do what I did there. And not only that, I enjoyed the experience. We talk about Notting Hill. I met some friends in the place called Peter's Field, and they told me to come up to Peter's Field and live. I said, no, I want to be around my people. So I stayed in London, and although it was a bit rough, I enjoyed it. I endured it, sorry, endured it. But I want to tell you something else. I'm a mover. So I was married and I had a baby. And we decided that we would move to Canada because the opportunities there were just, according to my wife, a lot better. When I got to Canada, I find that the education system was very, very good. So I enrolled. I was working on stuff. And I enrolled to come to do grade 12. And lo and behold, that means I would work morning shift and go to school in the evening. And then the evening shift, I'd go to school in the morning. And I completed grade 12 with a 70 average. And then I went to college. Grant McEwen Community College. Upgraded for university. And then I went to university and I was interviewed by a Barbadian professor. His brother, Sleepy Smith's brother. And I told my wife I'm tired putting standard 5 on my resume. So now I can put grade 12. After that, I started university, enrolled in psychology, but then I thought, this is not for me. I have 2 children, I'll send them to university. At that time, I worked my way with Dobbin in real estate. And I had 3 condominiums rented out and a 5-bedroom house living in. Now, why would I want to go to university? you know what I mean? It worked for me. Going from Barbados to England, that was my stepping stone. Because don't forget, in those days, you couldn't go to Canada except you had qualification. So that by going to England and becoming a registered nurse, my wife and I were able to get to Canada quite easily. And not only that, they paid the $735 for us, and we paid them back at half of 1%. And the guy told me, you'll never get that as long as you live again. He was right. But I'm thankful that I got the opportunity from the Barbados government at the time for us to go up to England. And as you said earlier about the reception we get upon our return, it was not very good, some of our Barbadians, the way they treated us or tried to treat us, returning national. That's derogatory. I don't like it. I'm not a returning national, I'm a Barbadian. Yes. So, I said this, I hope you'll stop referring to people as returning nationals. You know, I was a Barbadian, and if my life is spared, I'll be 84 this year. And I'm thankful. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This, I'm sure Dr. Carter will have some comments, but yes. I can assure you.
Let's have another question.
Another question is going to come, but you know, Dr. Carter did mention the importance of people documenting their stories.
Yes.
And I think that yours will most likely be the first story in whatever volume comes out, because it's pretty impressive, I tell you, and you say it very well. Next question. Another question, please.
Thank you, Dr. Carter, for very informative presentation. And I hope that my brother do take your advice and record his experience or his history. I agree with you that I'm talking with you. Conclusion before I ask you the question. I agree with you that history should be taught in schools. It is critical, crucial, important that got to be done. And like now, I've been waiting 40 years, 40 years for this period to come when we analyze the Windrush generation scandal. And I'll ask you these two questions. One, why did you not mention the 1959 Hurricane Janet? 1955 Hurricane Janet. That was after our exodus of thousands of people to Panama. Hurricane Janet was the next mass migration out of Barbados. And as your records show, not only Barbados, but the Caribbean. So that needs to be put into context. And Barbados was devastated by Hurricane Janet, and yet there has not been a social impact study done on Hurricane Janet. That needs to be done. And I would ask that you give that some thought. Secondly, you did not mention the 1959 Mental Health Act. You spoke of the 1958 race riots, but you didn't tie in the 1959 Mental Health Act that followed immediately after the race riots. The 1959 Mental Health Act was the first legal bit of legislation that gave the British authority to repatriate people to where they were born, in any part of the Commonwealth, but primarily to the Caribbean, because that was the major influx of people, as your lecture has explained. So what I would suggest is that you also look at that 1959 Mental Health Act. And because that is my special area of concern, I have waited 40 years. My case against the British health authorities from 1978, after I was put in a mental institution in 1977, my case is still in the British High Court after 42 years. Waiting for conclusion, I would, after this lecture series, I would hope that your department would sit down with me and look at the case of how the Mental Health Act affected our people, because all of us of my age know that it was a sin throughout the Caribbean. Those people coming back from England are right across the Caribbean, and that was not just a sin, it was reality based, not only on the people who were put in the mental institution and sent back, but because those of us who come back and try to enlighten Barbadians were called mad. Okay, so thank you very much, and I hope that your recommendation to government will find an ear of acceptance. Thank you.
Thank you very much for some very excellent observations. And the first one, Idalia Ferguson, my evidence comes from the advocate, and perhaps the advocate when it says these are batches of nurses, did not specify that they didn't, some of them, but that have actually done nursing, okay? But I'm glad that you pointed that out, because that's the importance of oral research or oral evidence, okay? Yes, that's what I'm saying. That's the importance of, you know, the oral account, because sometimes the newspapers don't always get it right. This, the second point I want to, Buddy made two excellent suggestions to factor in the Hurricane Janet in the equation. And I think I take your point, even though we see a large movement from 1953, the movement increases after 1955. So I take your point that that is something that we ought to look at closely, to look at the relationship between Hurricane Janet, because we had thousands of houses blown down, a lot of people displaced, and of course the movement after that. And the third thing you mentioned, or the second thing you mentioned, Reverend Laria, the relationship between the Mental Health Act of 1959 and efforts to curb migration. And I think that makes a good point, because we need to factor in all of this legislation. And of course, you know, you only had an hour. So you need to look at all the legislation. And I didn't even look at the 1971 legislation as well, or the 1961 legislation in detail. But this point that you're making calls for careful consideration. I take your point, and I think that it is important going forward that we look at all the parameters, look at the legislation that affected and curbed migration to the region, I mean to England. But thank you very much, both of you, for sharing your experiences. And Dolly, before I get to you, Mr. Doughty, you said you were?
Yes, sir.
Because I think you have a good story as well to tell. And Buddy, you have a very good story. And the objective of all of these lectures is to get you to write your stories.
We do have two comments from our online viewers.
Yes.
Good night. We have from Gabrielle R. She wanted to let you know this was an excellent lecture. She found it by chance and streamed it to the TV so that her parents could watch it. And both of them were migrants to England and Canada and enjoyed the presentation very much. In fact, her mother was actually one of the brave young women who went out as a nurse in 1957. We have from... We have from Zaria S. She has a question. How did migration impact relationships of gender, both in Barbados and host societies, such as the UK, during and post Windrush?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Give us another question.
I know you said that many Barbadians do not know anything about the Windrush, but I live in England and I find that's a lot of English people that doesn't know anything about the Windrush. I go to pubs and clubs and things like that, and this, they ask me, I mean, I only been in England in 1972, so that was a long time ago, but, you know, and this thing, if you come on Windrush, the other thing is about this return needle.
Yeah.
I mean, I come back to Barbados almost every year, and I just get called a return needle, and to me it sounds like an illness.
Yeah.
I get very annoyed about it because of me, and. I just think that England has done a lot for the people who kind of immigrated to England. I mean, some of the things that we achieve like the gentleman behind there.
Yes.
I mean, you probably wouldn't have done it over here. Now, finally, I'd like to say that when I went to school in Barbados, I learned about Elizabeth II, Henry, Thomas Cranmer, Thomas Cromwell, you know, but I only knew that that it was slavery back when I was about to leave school that started to introduce West Indian history. So I think putting it on the curriculum about West Indian history would be, I mean, the full of West Indian slavery, I think, because it's probably been hidden for such a long time. But when I was in school, it was, maybe people didn't want to say, talk about it. I don't know what you think about that.
Yeah. Good question. Another question, yes.
Greetings. I thought the lecture was very informative, yes, thanks, but I only hear the sanitizing of the immigrants. From my research and doing reading certain books, a lot of the, how you put it over, it was like, you know, it was welcome and, you know, everything was fine and dandy. But in my research, I realized that people going over there had like a culture shock, even the sharing bath water. And you know, the whole vibe, there was like, you had listed some ones coming together and forming an organization to look after the other ones that coming in, which is very good. But then there was thousands of other ones that never experienced that or didn't have that and had to fend for themselves. And my real question to you is, do you feel if the mother country had paid reparations to the blacks right after emancipation, would there be a need for that form of migration, or there would have been better established where they are, they would have probably go back to where they came from and establish then a stronger place on the continent? What's your opinion on the reparation aspect and the migration aspect? Because over the years, I don't see much has changed. Although we have come now to 2019, we are better educated, but we still look to migrate. You know, things still look fuzzy. It's not clear. We educated, but we still look to the same other country to help push us forward. Give thanks. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Excellent, excellent ideas. I want to respond quickly to all four points. First of all, let's deal with the last speaker. You said that the lecture tended to sanitize the migrant experiences. I alluded to the fact that, of course, it was not easy to go into England. And I didn't have the chance to go into what happened in England in detail, because that's going to come. We have Professor Cobley, we have Elizabeth Watson, etc. But the migrants will tell you that many of them went down to England and they were not really prepared in terms of the clothing. Okay? Many will tell you that for the first time they saw white people sweeping the streets, that type of thing. It was a culture shock to many of them. I mean, there are people who talked about racism, blatant racism, and a whole host of problems. My role as a lecturer tonight was to set the context and not to deal in terms of what actually happened in England, etc., because all the others are going to deal with that, okay? So I didn't think that it was important to do that. But you asked another question about reparations. If the blacks were given reparations in 1834, whether it would be, whether they would have still had to go to England for socioeconomic betterment. I don't really know. And that's the honest answer. You can't really tell what might have happened over a 100-year period 1834, and of course, 1954. That's a long time. What I could say, however, is that if blacks had been given reparations in 1834, or I should say compensation in 1834, like the planters were given compensation, 20 million pounds, they might have bought land. You would have seen a redistribution of land tenure practices. Many of them would have bought houses. Many of them might have been in business with that compensation money, okay? I say don't know because even when you look at the planters got $20 million, 20 million pounds. But 10 years after, the sugar industry was in trouble. Plantations were going bankrupt. And the question is, where did they do with the money? What did they do with the money? Okay? So that compensation money might not have benefited some plantations because a lot of them were already in debt and had to use that compensation money to pay off debts. And a lot of plantations failed in the 1850s, 60s, especially in Jamaica, in St. Vincent, and the industry went downhill. So I'm saying, therefore, that you can't really tell what might have happened. What we can say, however, is that it is important to look at the history, educate our people, so that slavery, or so that these unfortunate incidents don't keep reoccurring. And our friend in the front seat raised the issue of people not knowing about Windrush, even people in Britain not knowing about Windrush. And it is because of ignorance. We need to spend more time educating ourselves, educating the public. But of course, there's this stumbling block that history is a bunch of dates and is a waste of time. In terms of the concept of returning national, that concept again has gained currency in this island because of ignorance. I don't think we have educated our people about the significance and the value of this migrant experience, and not only the UK migrant experience, but migrant experiences from Panama, etc. And you know, the Panama people were given the term Panama men. They came back here as Panama men. They were given that term. I take your point that it sounds ugly to use the term returning national, because you're Barbadians who moved out to better yourself and moved out to better other Barbadians back at home as well, because a lot of that money and a lot of those pounds came back, and of course barrels, to benefit Barbados. So I think it is important going forward to see our migrants as Barbadians who work hard for a living, who experience all sorts of unfortunate circumstances, and are now returning home to educate other Barbadians on that experience. In terms of the question that was asked over the chat, I think it was, about the impact on gender. The lecturer on, I think Professor Dr. Burrows will look at this issue of the transnational family. But yes, I mean, so many people were left behind. So many young girls were left behind. And that's the unfortunate problem. I mean, in our family, when my sister went away, she left her daughter behind. Of course, our daughter recently joined her, but that is the unfortunate thing about migration. And I want to identify my sister, who is in the audience, Joyce Haynes. Joyce, could you stand up and let everybody see you? Joyce was in England just recently, and she was staying with some of our Barbadian people who migrated to Britain, and I think they migrated to Wales, our family who migrated to Wales in the 1960s. So to answer the question on the chat, many young girls were left to be brought up by their grandparents, and of course, these people sometimes were sent for after a while. So I just want to, I hope I've answered all the questions fairly and honestly.
We have room for one other question. If yes, there is the last question here, sure.
Mine is just a comment. I don't know if someone will be dealing with the question of the remittances and the impact of the remittances on the economy of the Caribbean, because just now there will be no more remittances. All the people who went in those days, they have their children in England and America. There's no connection to Barbados anymore. Because the parents have died, they come back, they will go just now.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think Caribbean economists have to take this into account. Yeah. It's not history, it's the future. We wouldn't be having remittances. Thank you.
Yes, we may not be having remittances, but some of these people buy land and invest in land and house. They may even buy boats as well. Okay, so there's some investment still coming, I hope. And I hope that next year, when we have our 2020 celebrations, that we could get that point across, that even though we are into the second and third generations, and we're not sending back home remittances, we are asking and pleading with Barbadians abroad to invest in their country and help to build the country. But that's a good point. During this lecture series, we were hoping for a full lecture on the economic impact of migration on Britain and here in Barbados as well. But the person who we had asked to do it could not do it at this time, but hopefully going forward, we can have that economic analysis done.
Sorry, we have one more question from online. And this question is coming from Gabrielle Art. And she wants a little bit of clarification on the motion you mentioned that the British government wanted to pass to restrict immigration from the colonies. And she wants to know if it did cut migration off and or did it continue in a smaller amount?
That's a very good question. My lecture focused on the period 48 to 61. But when you look at the period up to 1961, we see about 18,000 people, and these are estimates, 18,000 people having migrated. There are estimates that up to 1980, when you look at the whole period, according to one estimate, it puts the figure between 50 and 55,000 people. So my answer, therefore, is that even though the Act of 1962 was planned to curtail that migration between 62 and about 71, or even after 71, more people migrated, so that we have a total figure of about 50,000 or so Barbadians. So it really did not stop that migration, because we know a lot of people left by plane in the 1960s. And the reason here is that a lot of this migration is government sponsored, it is managed in an organized way, and people are moving.
Well, thank you very much, and I want to give a special thanks again to Dr. Carter.
You're welcome.
I am not going to say much because I'm going to thank him again. But I want to thank the audience for all of your very piercing questions, in some cases, and observations, and also for those recollections, which indeed were true vignettes of, should we say, not just life in Britain, but life in Barbados, and as we say, life in Canada even, and life generally, and the ups and downs, the vicissitudes, and all those things that matter to us so much. One observation I would make, or rather I'd make two observations, based on two comments which were made, that we must never forget, and I'm not giving a lecture, but we must never forget that migration is essentially a transnational and a global phenomenon. And the migration that we're dealing with in this lecture series is really only one small element in global migration. And there's a whole body of migration studies, from the migration from the UK to the US, migration to Australia, and from India, Sri Lanka in particular. Yeah. So I just say that to indicate that what we're doing here is obviously highly relevant and very focused, but we have to bear in mind that migration as a transnational phenomenon cannot be forgotten, and some of the lessons, or well, rather not necessarily the lessons, but some of the theoretical underpinnings in that type of migration cannot be lost on our own experience as well. I also join with Dr. Carter in expressing the fact that we wouldn't have a lecture specifically on remittances, but I am sure, as I said in my opening remarks of this series a little earlier, that there are issues related to remittances and the effect of remittances on the economy in terms of growth, inequality, exchange rates, and even inflation. And even if we don't have our lecture here, it may well be that when Dr. Carter is ready to edit his work and bring out his book, he's bringing out one already, but I mean his other book, he brings them out all the time, that someone will contribute that particular yes. chapter dealing with that element of remittances. So there isn't really much more for me to say. At the beginning I said it would be one of balance, and I think it's fair to say that indeed it was one of balance, and I wish to once again applaud Dr. Carter for taking us from 1948 to 1962 and giving us a sterling lecture filled with much food for thought in a very balanced way and from a very balanced perspective. So once again, I would remind you that you can join the club, because the next lecture is actually called Join the Club. And it's called Migrants at Play, Join the Club. And it's going to be here at the museum's walled garden. I'll say a little about that before closing. And that's going to be given by Professor Alan Cobley. And I think it's March 27th, 2019. But read your little handout and go on the museum's website and just be sure. And this is the newest structure here in the museum, the Walled Garden Theatre. And we were very fortunate, through a lot of private subscription, to put this structure up 3 years ago to house our first Barbados Independent Film Festival. And we've now hosted three Barbados Independent Film Festivals here. and we've hosted many other things, you know, Handel's Messiah and the like, all embracing the arts and culture and living and life right here in this walled garden structure. So we're very glad that the lecture series, we're now hosting for the first time the lecture series here, and every night that we host we will start at 6 so that we can finish as we are now around 7:45, and you have a whole night ahead of you to do whatever you want to do. So thank you once again, and thank Dr. Carter again for gracing us. Thank you. As the Romans would say, discedere licet, you may now leave.
Thank you for coming. And for introducing me.
Thank you, man.
Wonderful lecture. Thank you. Well, enjoy doing the research.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Well done.